the next session to open, please. I call upon the chairpersons and the speakers. Dr. Bassem Bayrouti, Dr. Nourmeen.
It's a great pleasure to open this last session in that day. I have the pleasure to present Dr. Bassem Bayrouti, is assistant professor in King Abdulaziz Hospital. He is going to discuss Hughes syndrome.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد I would like to thank the scientific committee for giving me the opportunity to participate in this Pan-Arab Hematology Association conference in great city Cairo. That's me. I do work in two institutions in King Abdulaziz where I teach, and in King Faisal, where I do bone marrow transplant. My presentation is about antiphospholipid syndrome, the multifaceted disease, or what's called, according to the name of the physician who discovered this syndrome, the Hughes syndrome. I have no conflict of interest, and my presentation will be evidence-based. So to make things interesting, I will start with a case presentation to understand what's Hughes syndrome, how it is affecting our quality of life, especially women. And this is a real case, 36-year-old female. She is pregnant, gravida 9, para 5, plus 3. She had four living children. She had one intrauterine fetal death before. She was 24 weeks pregnant, and she presented to emergency with convulsions, and examination showed left leg swelling. Doppler ultrasound confirmed DVT, and her CBC showed white count of 8, hemoglobin of 8, and platelet count of 8. So DCT was positive, but LDH was normal. CT brain showed small subarachnoid hemorrhage, however MRI and MRV showed superior sagittal sinus thrombosis. So what's the diagnosis? The title of the presentation, Hughes syndrome. What's the differential diagnosis? So we have this woman, she has low platelet, low hemoglobin, could be TTP, could be DIC, could be APL, acute promyelocytic leukemia, it could be DIC, it could be any of these entities where there is thrombocytopenia, there is anemia, there is thrombosis, and there is a multifaceted problem, recurrent pregnancy loss. So how we will confirm this diagnosis, antiphospholipid? Which test we will do? And by the way, antiphospholipid has nothing to do with SLE, with lupus, nothing. I mean, seriously, except that 40% of patients with SLE, they can have antiphospholipid, but only 5% of patients with antiphospholipid, they can have SLE. So what investigation we should do to confirm the diagnosis of antiphospholipid? The lupus anticoagulant, anticardiolipin antibody, IgG, IgA, IgM, and beta-2 glycoprotein, IgG, IgA, IgM. And these tests should be done 2 times, 3 months apart. How you will manage this patient? So we have the problem list. She has severe thrombocytopenia, she has thrombosis, 2 sites, and she might qualify for catastrophic antiphospholipid. So we have to be careful here. If there is catastrophic, then we need to do more things. So she has thrombocytopenia, she has catastrophic antiphospholipid or possible two-site thrombosis, DVT and spherocytic sign of thrombosis. Because the catastrophic, we need to have three thromboses 1 week apart. So she doesn't qualify yet. And she has mild anemia, low MCV, and she's pregnant. So the treatment first, we should look at the platelet. She has ITP secondary to antiphospholipid, and we manage these patients during pregnancy with IVIG and low-dose steroid. I don't like high-dose steroid in pregnancy. It will cause gestational diabetes, and it will increase the pregnancy-induced hypertension. But low-dose steroid with IVIG, I will give 1 gram per kilogram per day, and she was given this platelet improved from 8 to 32, so this enabled me to start full-dose anticoagulation using glomerulate heparin, 1 milligram per kilogram, BID, throughout pregnancy, and after pregnancy, we switch her to warfarin. And she had successful course. The patient made it, and the baby was delivered. And post-delivery, she was on warfarin. She came with TIA, so I added aspirin to warfarin because, as we will see, antiphospholipid is a disease that will cause thrombosis in the artery and thrombosis in the veins and thrombosis in the capillaries causing multi-organ failure. So, and it will cause also hemorrhage. So this syndrome is not only a thrombosis. It is a thrombohemorrhagic syndrome. And that's what I told Dr. Naveen this afternoon, that we should really, as Pan-Arab Hematology Association, initiate the change from thromboembolic to thrombohemorrhagic. And the entity that internists, they are taking the lead and leading thrombosis with the new oral anticoagulant, we should be very careful, and we need hematology to be on board, because management of bleeding in these syndromes, thrombohemorrhagic, is so serious, plus the new oral anticoagulant management of bleeding is very difficult. But the concept of thrombohemorrhagic syndrome in antiphospholipid was there since 2004, till 2013, where it is accepted in the International Society of Hemostasis and Thrombosis. And that's the mother, and that's her heart, and that's what our role as doctors, physicians, to protect our mothers from thrombohemorrhagic syndromes. And that's how I look at my role. So what can kill these mothers during pregnancy? Two entities, always tragic. When you have a young woman pregnant, all of a sudden she either collapsed because of pulmonary embolism or she will have postpartum hemorrhage. So these two entities, we need experience and how to manage. So this is a girl who lost her mother because of pulmonary embolism, and it will deliver a clear message to everyone that we should be careful when we deal with these patients. And it is in Arabic. I like poetry, and at the end of the day, we should have some entertainment. So this girl, she's saying, أنبأتكم عن الأسى نظراتي عندما جئت في حفلة الأمهات قصتي بالدموع أروي أساها حين ضاقت بشرحها كلماتي تتوارى أستاذتي وهي خجلة حين جاءت بأظرف الدعوات حيرتها بطاقتي من ستدعو أمها لم تعد بركب الحياة جئت مهزومة الخطى في عيوني ألف بؤس يموج بالعبارات كل بنت بأمها تتباهى وأرى لا أرى سوى ذكرياتي كنت بالأمس مثلهن أباهي بك أمي أفوق كل البنات كل ركن أرى به طيف أمي ثم يمضي كأنني في سباتي من هنا أقبلت كأني أراها لم يزل بعد ريحها في عباتي وقفت عند باب فصلي وألقت نحو عيني ألطف النظرات نطقت عينها وللعين وحي فاق والله منطق الكلمات يا ابنتي يا حشاشة القلب سيري للمعالي بوثبة وثبات لم يزل صوتها الشجي بأذني وهواها يمر كالنسمات أين أمي سألتكم لا تجيبوا إنما من يجيبني دمعاتي أين صدر الحنان ما عدت ألقى بعدها من يعيذني من شتاتي مثلها الشمس حين غابت غشاني ليل هم مكبل الظلمات كنت أنسى بعينها كل همي وأواري بحضنها حسراتي هي بالأمس زورقي وشراعي في حياة تموج بالفاجعات دمعة فوق قبرها ودعتني ثم ودعت فوقها أمنياتي في حياتي وجدت ما شئت لكن بعد أمي فقدت طعم الحياة الحمد لله. So how big this antiphospholipid, how big this woman going through these problems, I think it's significant. And we are still facing significant maternal morbidity and mortality. And in my opinion, nothing can replace the loss of a young mother. What about males? Don't worry, they don't get pregnant, so leave us, we know what we are doing. So, do you know what does mean obstetric mean? Obstetric is a Latin word. It means obstare, stand by. So these women, during pregnancy, they need someone to stand by them, to help them if they are in need of help. And that's what our rule, whatever subspecialty we are doing. So that's the obstetric, stand by. Antiphospholipid is the multifaceted disease, and that's the what I'm aiming today is increase awareness of antiphospholipid and define the antiphospholipid and then put the 10 rules of antiphospholipids. There are two diseases that hit the humanity last centuries. Antiphospholipid 1983 and AIDS 1984. Unfortunately, AIDS got more publicity, but antiphospholipid described by Graham Hughes is more important in my opinion. APS is a real multifaceted disease. It should be in the differential diagnosis of any symptom in addition to lymphoma and TB. Physicians should have a high alert of investigating patients presenting with signs and symptoms to prevent further morbidity and mortalities. Should we screen everyone presenting with these signs and symptoms, we have to find the prevalence of each and cost effectiveness. The cardinal manifestations of this antiphospholipid is thrombosis, pregnancy loss, and thrombocytopenia, but there are new entities added to this syndrome, including renal complication, including renal artery stenosis. It's one of the manifestations of antiphospholipid. New in orthopedic also, like rib and metatarsal fracture, cardiovascular atherosclerosis, we know, cardiac valvular disease, acute myocardial infarction, failed angioplasty, diastolic dysfunction, intracardiac thrombosis, cardiomyopathy, Berger's disease, obstetric, recurrent pregnancy loss, pregnancy-induced hypertension, preeclampsia, eclampsia, intrauterine growth retardation, HELLP syndrome, all these could be manifestations of antiphospholipid. APS can induce acquired protein C resistance. It can inhibit protein C. It can induce acquired protein S deficiency. So be careful to mislabel these women with protein low protein S, saying these patients they have antiphospholipid. APS can induce ADTS pseudothrombocytopenia, and that's a common phenomenon. Anytime you have this rule, antiphospholipid. Beta 2 glycoprotein 1 is a complement inducer, and that's why in this syndrome, unfractionated heparin and low molecular heparin are complement inhibitors, so prevent recurrent pregnancy loss, unlike the fondaparinux or hirudoxine. Lupus anticoagulant is associated with venous, and anticardiolipin is associated with arterial, but any of these antibodies can be associated with thrombosis. APS can be found in 50% of patients with ITP, and that's why I do always screen patients with ITP for antiphospholipid, and also can be associated with platelet dysfunction, and that's the thrombohemorrhagic part, that a syndrome can cause low platelet bleeding and can cause platelet dysfunction bleeding. So it's not only thrombosis, it can cause bleeding. APS is associated with paradoxical syndrome of cerebral infarction or superior sinus thrombosis with ITP and subarachnoid hemorrhage, and that's why we shouldn't be misled by CT findings. We should always do MRI. APS can be associated with bleeding due to ITP, platelet dysfunction, factor 2 deficiency inhibitor, or prolonged PT rather than PTT. I do have a patient with acquired factor 8 inhibitor, acquired factor 13 inhibitor. So this syndrome can present with bleeding and thrombosis. APS tested is recommended before any reconstructive vascular surgery, including bypass, to prevent early graft thrombosis. Patients with biopsy-proven myocardial small vessel thrombosis or those with intracardiac thrombi should be considered for meeting the criteria for APS. APS pregnant patients have high alpha-fetoprotein beta-HCG in serum, and this may contribute to the recurrent pregnancy loss. APS is the most important prothrombotic cause of recurrent pregnancy loss, and in the ACCP guidelines, it is the only disease that we should screen women with recurrent pregnancy loss, not other thrombophilic states. With intervention, the outcome improved from 20% to 80% of live birth, and that's what all these women with recurrent pregnancy loss, secondary to antiphospholipid, they will take aspirin, enoxaparin twice a day throughout pregnancy and 6 weeks after pregnancy, and they have successful outcome, no bleeding, no thrombosis, no loss of the mother, no loss of the baby. The clinical trial of thrombosis venous or arterial, recurrent pregnancy loss and thrombocytopenia, lab triad, lupus anticoagulant, anticardiolipin, and beta-2 glycoprotein. Antiphospholipid antibodies now, it's different from the syndrome, because syndrome we need the clinical and the laboratory, but antibodies, they are present in the general population 2 to 7%, up to 12% in elderly, 3 to 17% in patients with acute coronary syndrome, and venous thromboembolism, up to 18% in patients with stroke, up to 5 to 15% in patients with coronary artery disease, 7 to 42% in patients with fetal loss. So the risk of these positive antibodies for thrombosis and recurrent events. And that's why in the guidelines they say women with antiphospholipid antibodies without any events, they recommend surveillance or prophylaxis during and postpartum. But women with antibodies, even without any event postpartum, they should get VTE prophylaxis for 6 weeks. And I always give low molecular heparin, enoxaparin, instead of going through the oral and the drug interaction and food interaction. Neurological manifestation of antiphospholipid, the stroke, that's the most common, but there are other manifestations, including the chorea, migraine, psychosis, epilepsy, cerebral vein thrombosis, cerebral artery thrombosis, retinal vein thrombosis, hypoperfusion on SPECT scan, sensorineural hearing loss, transverse myelopathy, cognitive impairment, pseudotumor cerebri, and multiple sclerosis-like syndromes. All this could be a manifestation of neurological manifestation of antiphospholipid. GI, hepatic necrosis, acalculus cholecystitis, intestinal ischemia, celiac artery stenosis, because it's one of the features of this disease, stenosis of vessels, whether renal, celiac, coronary artery, endocrine adrenal insufficiency, hypopituitarism, pulmonary embolism in situ without DVT. So thrombosis in situ, pulmonary hypertension, ARDS, bone, avascular necrosis, bone marrow necrosis, fractures. Skin livedo reticularis, what they call it is pathognomic, hematological thrombocytopenia, autoimmune hemolytic anemia, Evans syndrome, and microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. Renal glomerular thrombosis, renal artery stenosis, renal insufficiency, renal vein thrombosis, renal artery thrombosis. And there are new criteria that are adding, like neurological migraine, seizures, chorea, cardiovascular, the atherosclerosis, myocardial infarction, peripheral vascular disease, valvular abnormality, and new criteria. This is the livedo reticularis. Digital gangrene, it's one of the pathognomic features of antiphospholipid. We always see it in ICU. So when I do consult, I do screen this patient because the management will be affected, and other organ manifestations. The pregnancy morbidity, it's not only recurrent pregnancy loss, also placental. So if there is aprapsio, it's one of the manifestations of antiphospholipid syndrome. So loss of pregnancy, either 3 below 10 weeks or 1 above 10 weeks or intrauterine fetal death beyond 34 weeks. This is the Sapporo laboratory criteria of diagnosis of antiphospholipid, and they need anticardiolipin antibody beta 2 glycoprotein 1 and lupus anticoagulant. And they do talk about titer, but I think we have to have high standard lab in order to call depend on titer. So in my lab, although we are in good institutions in the university or King Faisal, I depend if it is positive, repeat 3 months plus the clinical scenario. That's what I depend. I depend more on clinical scenario rather than lab criteria. So the pregnancy comorbidities that we should be aware is preeclampsia, preterm labor, placental apraxia, intrauterine growth retardation or restriction, or oligohydramnios are all, if they are unexplained, this is a clue that this woman has antiphospholipid. So that's the take-home message. Physicians should still consider the diagnosis of antiphospholipid syndrome and commence treatment according to the clinical judgment after exclusion of secondary causes of these clinical scenarios. So any connective tissue disease, especially SLE and Jogner syndromes, they can have up to 30 to 50% antiphospholipid antibodies, and this can be associated with antiphospholipid syndrome later on. So these women or men, they can have these autoimmune diseases and antiphospholipid thrombotic events. Recurrent event of thrombosis, fetal loss, family history of antiphospholipid, all these are indications of antiphospholipid antibody screening. Thrombosis at unusual site, recurrent superficial thrombophlebitis, and warfarin-induced skin necrosis. Usually precipitated by surgery. So in this catastrophic antiphospholipid, it is rare but associated with high mortality. Usually precipitated by surgery, so as a woman can enter for simple procedure like colposcopy or whatever, and then this procedure will lead to activation of these antibodies and catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome. And these patients, they need anticoagulation, they need plasma exchange, they may benefit from rituximab, and as I mentioned, it is mortality is high, and it is seen in patients with SLE, 50%, and primary antiphospholipid, 40%, and patient with antithrombin 3 deficiency. And the criteria is three organs, small vessels or large vessels, like lung, kidney, CNS, heart, skin, within 1 week. And these women, these patients with antiphospholipid, they have higher incidence of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. So how we can split the antiphospholipid syndrome from antibodies? Syndrome, we need the clinical and laboratory. Antibodies, it's the only lab, but we have to take care when these patients are going through high-risk situation. Sometimes, falsely negative and falsely positive antiphospholipid. So falsely negative can be seen in acute thrombosis, steroid therapy, and nephrotic syndrome. So don't be misled. If you have the clinical scenario, you rely on the clinical scenario. Also can be antiphospholipid antibody can be falsely positive in acute thrombosis, again, as epiphenomena, in sometimes drugs, infection, and so how we can differentiate primary antiphospholipid from secondary. If there is malar or discoid rash, this is more with secondary. Oral pharyngeal nasal ulceration towards also with secondary. Frank arthritis, pleurisy. So all these features associated with SLE. So this could be secondary antiphospholipid. Causes of antiphospholipid can be autoimmune diseases like systemic vasculitis, Crohn's disease, infections, HIV, syphilis, hepatitis C, very important. And this, sometimes you see these patients common in Egypt, the hepatitis C, and you see many of these manifestation of thrombosis, it will be antiphospholipid mediated. Mycoplasma drugs, chlorpromazine, quinine, hydralazine, procainamide, phenytoin, interferon alpha, can all cause antiphospholipid antibodies. Malignancy, hematological or solid, so that's one of the mechanisms of cancer-associated thrombosis. So the 10 rules that I will finish my presentation. Rule number one, antiphospholipid is clinical more than laboratory diagnosis. Rule number two, differential diagnosis of thrombosis during pregnancy. And rule number three, antiphospholipid syndrome and antibodies, when to expect, what to expect, and the falsely positive, falsely negative antiphospholipid antibodies, and the catastrophic antiphospholipid syndrome. And rule number six, APS, when to screen and how to be cost effective, as we mentioned. Rule number seven, APS primary versus secondary, we have to split this. And number eight, always think of HIT and antiphospholipid in any intervention, interventional procedure, because of unfractionated heparin more than low mercury heparin infidelity. So these patients with going for procedure, they go unfractionated heparin, they develop HIT, think that they have also antiphospholipid. Rule number nine, for women with antiphospholipid antibody syndrome with positive history of DVT, they should receive low mercury heparin therapeutic during antenatal and postnatal and prophylactic 40 if for recurrent pregnancy loss. So women with antiphospholipid, there is history of thrombosis, they will go on therapeutic low mercury heparin 1 milligram per kilogram twice a day throughout pregnancy, 6 weeks postpartum. If they have only recurrent pregnancy loss, it will be prophylactic 40 milligram once a day throughout pregnancy, 6 weeks postpartum. And for any patient with antiphospholipid, add aspirin 100 milligram PO once a day. Thank you very much. I will leave my presentation stop. No copyright, please.
Thank you. I have to leave,
Dr. Amin. I have a flight to catch, so if I will take one or two questions, and then I will run away.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Basim Periouti, for your very illustrative and you cover a very serious and challenging disease. If you have any questions because of, yes. Kindly introduce yourself.
Ines Abdelmati, this is Musaf Jamat and Shams. Thank you for this nice presentation, but I want to ask about anticoagulation in thrombocytopenic patient with heparin. As you mentioned before in presentation, they are more susceptible for HIT. If they are thrombocytopenic and I am afraid of HIT, I will not know in clinical or laboratory basis.
In this patient, antiphospholipid with thrombocytopenia and thrombosis, I will use low mercury weight heparin. The bleeding risk is less. It doesn't need monitoring, because be careful if you will use unfractionated heparin. These patients, they can have lupus anticoagulant positive and they can have baseline PTT 55 or 60, and you cannot do based on this base unless you will do anti-10A level, which is not available everywhere.
I object for low molecular weight heparin as it has also a risk of HIT, a low risk of HIT.
Absolutely.
I want to use another anticoagulation other than heparin. What do you think?
Other anticoagulation, yeah. Like what?
Arkestra or?
Which one?
Arkestra or?
Fondaparinux. Yeah. So for HIT positive, absolutely, I will use fondaparinux. But for HIT negative, we should use low mercury weight heparin.
I will not know the patient if it's HIT positive or negative, because the patient will be from thrombocytopenic.
I
don't know if it is from disease or from HIT. So I don't like to use.
So we'll do the T score, the 4T score. If it is high, I will not use low mercury weight heparin or unfractionated heparin. I will use fondaparinux. I will send for HIT assay. If positive, I will continue fondaparinux. If negative, I will switch to low mercury weight heparin.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Very good.
Any more questions?
Yes.
Please introduce yourself, please. No? Okay. Thank you, Dr. Basim. Thank you very much. We are thankful about the Qasida also, because
thank you very much.
Nice. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum.
Professor Dr. Zahir Adam, apologize. And we have to start with Professor Ghaffar Rajab. is a professor of internal medicine in Cairo University. He's going to cover cryoglobulinemia, new guideline in classification.
I'd like to thank the organizing committee of the Pan-Arab Hematology Conference, and a special thanks go to the Secretary General, Dr. Professor Mirbat Matar, for the kind invitation. I'm pleased to be here with you today. Being honored, or I don't know if it is the finale of the meeting, I hope you can bear with me after all these long days and hours of discussions and presentations. So I hope you are not exhausted as to follow my part of the day. بالمناسبة يعني I would like to express my pleasure to be with Dr. Nermin Addah, يعني the dear professor of pediatric hematology. يعني العلاقة تمتد لمدة طويلة في الماضي والاحترام الكبير لها وسعيدني إن هي sharing the session. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Cryoglobulinemic vasculitis validation study. We'll go through this presentation through some few phases. I would like, if you are not in a hurry, I can go through the first part, which is an introductory part to the last part, which describes the study, the validation study of the classification criteria. Mixed cryoglobulinemia is a systemic disease that results in the presence of mixed cryoglobulins, defined as plasma proteins composed of immunoglobulins and precipitating reversibly at low temperature. The cryoglobulin types are, the major types that we see in this syndrome are type 2, the cryoglobulins where the cryoglobulins consist of monoclonal immunoglobulin, usually an M-kappa part that has rheumatoid activity against polyclonal IgGs, and type 3, which is less commonly encountered in these cases, are characterized by a combination of polyclonal immunoglobulins. This is the definition. In type 1, it's solely in monoclonal gammopathy. Let's go to the background. The first description of the cryoglobulins as called precipitable protein is discovered in the serum of a patient with multiple myeloma, and this was reported by Winthrop. Winthrop, if you have studied the history of hematology, introduced his method of ESR estimation, which was successfully replaced or supplanted by the Westergren technique later on. The terms cryoglobulin and cryoglobulinemia are proposed, and the phenomena is observed in various diseases by Lerner and Watson. Excuse me, by Watson. The chromatographic separation shows their mixed S and 19S nature, and rheumatoid factor activity was found to be associated to the 19S fraction in 1962. Then the clinical picture and the structural heterogeneity of the so-called essential mixed cryoglobulinemia are clearly defined by Meltzer and Franklin, where they describe this entity and the Meltzer triad composed of neuritis, rash, and the arthritis. The different cryoglobulins are immunochemically characterized, and their significance as inducers of tissue lesions is emphasized by Wager et al. And by Barnett et al. Let's go faster than this. The cryoglobulins were, in 1974, classified into the three main types, and then the possible etiological role of hepatitis B virus in essential MC is claimed, though not confirmed in later studies. That was in 1977. In 1987, therapy with recombinant interferon alpha is shown to be effective in patients with essential MC, essential, is quoted between these marks because we were not aware of the exact cause of the majority of cases. In 1990, after the identification of the HCV, the large majority of patients with MC are found to be hepatitis C virus infected. In 2003, rituximab was introduced as a line of therapy, and in 2004, a B-cell clonal expansion involving rheumatoid factor secreting cells is demonstrated to be the biological hallmark of MC. In 2010, we have a combination of pegylated interferon alpha with ribavirin and rituximab as a triple therapy, or the PIRR therapy, is shown to provide a high percentage of long-term response by Sadoun in the group from Paris, and by Damaco F. et al. From Italy. Administration of new protease inhibitors in 2011 and anti-CD20 monoclonal antibodies ofatumumab is likely to result in better results than PIRR therapy. And the last part of our presentation will go through the developments in this regard. The chronic HCV infection and lymphoproliferation, there is an interplay between the HCV-positive patients, the type 2 mixed cryoglobulinemia, and the B-cell non-Hodgkin lymphoma. I think this part is your main interest here. The pathogenic model of cryoglobulinemic tissue damage describes this entity where we have a hypocomplementemia of C4, and later on we'll find a description of this deficiency of C4 or consumption of C4 to be one of the main features of the syndrome or the vasculitis. In HCV in B-cell targeting, we have a direct B-cell targeting. If we go through the line of infection plus autoimmunity, we go through the direction of the HCV targeting or the indirect B-cell targeting, which ends up with the autoimmune disease and lymphoma. Here we have the interplay or the overlap of many of these features. By MC, we mean the mixed cryoglobulinemia. It overlaps with HCV and with B-cell non-Hodgkin lymphoma, with autoimmune hepatitis, with rheumatoid arthritis or arthritis, and with primary Sjögren syndrome. They are all intersecting with one another or overlapping with one another. The differential diagnosis of HCV-associated membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis pattern of injury on biopsy, where we can have this, the kidney can be a target of this disease, where we have infections producing this entity, autoimmune disease, complement disorders, monoclonal immune deposition, chronic thrombotic microangiopathies, and the chronic liver disease, and malignancy without cryoglobulinemia. The rheumatologic manifestations during chronic cryoglobulinemic HCV infection present with arthritis or arthralgia, where we can have an association of rheumatoid factor. A Sjögren-Sitka syndrome-like, where we can meet NA or anti-RO or anti-LA, provided that the new criteria for the ACR or the American College of Rheumatology and the EULAR or the European League Against Rheumatology, they have the classification criteria where HCV is one of the exclusion criteria to diagnose primary Sjögren syndrome. If you need to diagnose Sjögren, you have to exclude HCV. But we have noticed here that we have a great deal of overlap and in symptoms and serology. Acrocyanosis or Raynaud's phenomena, we may encounter ANA positivity, leukocytoplastic vasculitis and ulcers. We may encounter ANCA positivity of the P or C, myalgias and fibromyalgias. We may have a thyroid disease or rheumatoid factor, antiphospholipid syndrome, where we may encounter ANA or anticardiolipin. I recall now that our friend and colleague, Dr. Hadi Gobran, he published a paper describing the antiphospholipids in HCV-associated diseases in Egyptian patients. A mono or a multineuropathy, where we may have evidence of vasculitis or anticardiolipin or ANA, or interstitial lung disease. Rarely we may encounter osteosclerosis with bone pain. The disorders and infections that may be associated with cryoglobulins are, we have a constellation of causes, either viral, where we have hepatitis C, which represents the majority of cases based, depending on the population studied, hepatitis A or B, human immunodeficiency virus, the herpes group, Epstein-Barr virus, varicella, cytomegalovirus, parvovirus, B19, blah, blah. Bacterial infections, we have the endocarditis, which is part of the differential diagnosis clinically and in lab tests, syphilis, rickettsia, Q fever, leprosy, Lyme disease, post-streptococcal nephritis. We have the fungal infections, and we have some parasitic infections. This all can contribute to cryoglobulin. This is the infectious part of it. But we have other reasons or other causes which can cause cryoglobulins. We have autoimmune disease, starting by Sjögren, systemic lupus, rheumatoid, dermatomyositis, and a long list of diseases. We have myelo- and lymphoproliferative disorders or diseases, B-cell non-Hodgkin lymphoma, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, multiple myeloma, Waldenstrom microglobulinemia, and other diseases. What are the demographic, clinical, and serological features of MC patients? The age of onset has a mean of 54 plus or minus 13. It tends to occur late in, after the start of the disease. It may be related to the exposure of the immune system to some antigens or from the gut after the introduction or the appearance of collaterals. We don't know so far. A female to male ratio was 3 in the group that was studied by Ferri et al. But I think in Egypt the ratio will not be the same. I think we have a predominance of males, reflecting a higher percentage in, among males. Disease duration and mean plus standard deviation is about 12 years, plus or minus 10. Clinically, the most important is the purpura or the vasculitic purpura. 98% of cases in the inferior group, weakness, arthralgia, arthritis, Raynaud's, Sicca syndrome, peripheral neuropathy, renal involvement, liver, thyroid, diabetes mellitus type 2, B-cell non-Hodgkin lymphoma, hepatocellular carcinoma. Perhaps it might be an association. Serologically, we have the cryocrit, the mean plus standard deviation in 4.4 up to 12%. Type 2 and type 3 mixed cryoglobulinemia, the ratio of 2 to 1. C3 consumption is not encountered, but C4 is more common. Anti-nuclear antibodies, anti-mitochondrial antibodies, anti-smooth muscle antibodies, anti-extractable nuclear antigen antibody, anti-HCV, 92%, anti-hepatitis B virus antibodies, and hepatitis B surface antigen. This is a resume of what we mentioned before, the infectious autoimmune and the myelo lymphoproliferative disease. The organs that can be involved in cryoglobulinemic syndrome are the liver, cirrhosis or hepatorenal syndrome, liver failure, hepatocellular carcinoma, sepsis, nephropathy, heart failure, lymphoproliferative disorders, neoplasm, CNS vasculitis, gastrointestinal vasculitis, lung vasculitis, hyperviscosity syndrome, a multi-organ failure. What about the catastrophic syndrome? Saccardo introduced this term where they borrowed from the anti-lipid syndrome, the catastrophic component of this syndrome, and it occurs when the terminology was borrowed from the antiphospholipid syndrome, but it's not related to the antiphospholipid syndrome. When in less than a week, 3 or more organ systems are affected by thrombosis. However, multi-organ failure is also a consequence in systemic vasculitis related to diseases other than the cryoglobulinemic syndrome. Catastrophic syndrome is often life-threatening. Autopsy findings show vasculitis of the cholecystic, pancreatic, gastrointestinal, and coronary vessels. There is a predilection to the GIT vessels in this entity. It remains unclear why severe vasculitis develops in only a few patients with cryoglobulinemic syndrome. Perhaps it's related to some form of genetic disorder or some kind of a polymorphism. There were attempts to see why 50 to 60% of recent epidemiological study of HCV develop cryoglobulinemia, whereas 2.5 to 4 at the maximum can develop the syndrome. We don't know. And we don't know why some of them would go to the catastrophic syndrome. But having the the insult with the heavy burden on the GIT may refer to the portal of entry through the GIT. It might be provoked by some microorganism. Serum obtained from a patient with cryoglobulinemia type 2 and HCV after 24 hours at 4 degrees centigrade, cryoprecipitate is clearly visible. This is usually a monoclonal component, but we usually keep it at this low temperature for 7 and sometimes 10 days. Otherwise, we may get false negative results. I always recommend to take the sample in the lab in a pre-warmed syringe and to do the centrifuge at 37 degrees as well, and to keep it for quite enough period not to satisfy ourselves with 3 or 4 days. We have to check after 1 day if we have this precipitate. It points to a monoclonal gammopathy, but we keep checking, and then we don't measure or estimate the cryocrit component until we have full 7 days at least. Colleagues in the clinical pathology department would wait till 10 days before they say that they have or they don't have or estimate the cryocrit. The cutaneous cryoglobulinemic vasculitis can present, this is the case of a 50-year-old man with 20-year history of hepatitis C infection, presenting with malaise, fever, chills, cough, petechial lower extremity rash, top left. Splinter hemorrhages, top right. And palmar and digital erythema. Examination revealed diffuse petechia and hyperpigmentation and black punctate scarring over the lower leg, evidence of healed episodes of vasculitis. This is a biopsy of the case where it reveals vaso-occlusive thrombi and small vessel neutrophilic vasculitis. We call it the leukocytoclastic vasculitis because it affects the post-capillary vessels, venules mainly. This is the main brunt of the attack. And because we have an abundance of neutrophils and debris of neutrophils in the pathology. But sometimes we can encounter some lymphocytes or even xenophils, which may be associated with severe itching. And sometimes even some histiocytes. Cryoglobulinemic vasculitis with libido racemosa and ulceration. The libido racemosa is a variant like the libido reticularis, but it's usually associated with pathological conditions. And the middle-aged female presented with extensive libido racemosa, top left, and geographic ulcers with steep, violaceous edges over the lower extremities, top right. This is a rare case, or not a rare case, an unusual case of peripheral neuropathy and central nervous system involvement in the cryoglobulinemia. The number one, A, is a sagittal, and here we have where the white arrow points to some myelopathy. Hyperintensity with mild spinal cord swelling at T2 to 3 level in an HCV infected patient with partial transverse myelitis. And here we have periventricular lesions, but these are due to the vasculitic process. What is the validation study of cryoglobulinemic vasculitis intends to do? The preliminary results were published in Madrid in the EULAR meeting of Madrid 2014, and later on published in presented in San Diego of the same year. What do we mean by validation study? And what do we mean by classification criteria? Diagnosis, let us have an example in acute myocardial infarction, an example that we all encounter. By definition, it's an ischemic coagulative necrosis of myocardial tissues. By definition, it's a disease process, or in general, it's a disease process present in any patient that justify assignment of the diagnosis, one named without myocardial infarction. So a classification criteria are observations that classify a specific patient into a standardized category for study. They are meant for study, to compare groups in different geographic places or different centers, and to make sure that we are studying the same group of patients, the same entities, the same category of patients. So it is meant for study mainly. Very, very rarely we rely on the classification criteria for diagnosis. if we apply this definition on myocardial infarction, we would say that any two of the following symptoms of myocardial ischemia, rise or fall of cardiac troponin, and EKG or ECG changes indicative of new ischemia or imaging evidence of new loss of viable myocardium. So if you go to the diagnostic part of it, what are the diagnostic criteria meant to describe? These are observations that demonstrate or confidently predict the presence of the defining features of a disease in a specific patient. A specific patient and not a group for a study. Any two of the following symptoms of myocardial ischemia, rise or fall of cardiac troponin, ECG changes indicative of new ischemia or imaging evidence of new loss of viable myocardium. But if we apply this to other entities like polyarthritis nodosa, we have in the diagnosis a medium artery aneurysm seen on imaging or a necrotizing arthritis seen on biopsy or a negative ANCA and no CLNS in the kidney and no evidence of glomerulonephritis. This will describe a diagnostic criteria. So the classification criteria are meant to identify group of patients for a study group to compare between different centers or in different geographic localities. We have to make a consensus on what we are going to study so as to compare these groups. But for individual patients, we rely on the diagnostic criteria. In this regard, the medium artery necrotizing arthritis can be seen on biopsy, negative ANCA, no MCLNS, and no evidence of glomerulonephritis can be the classification criteria of polyarthritis nodosa. The cryoglomerulonephritis vasculitis validation study was meant to as a validation part of a previous study which put on some classification criteria for the cryoglobulinemic syndrome. The preliminary classification criteria for cryoglobulinemic vasculitis were developed in 2011 by an European cooperative study headed by De Vita in the University of Udine and was published in the Annals of Rheumatic Disease in the year 2011. With the objectives of this study, the validation study, is that we have classification criteria, and these were studied in a group of patients where we got the results. If we need to reproduce the data, or if we manage to reproduce the data in another group of patients, are totally different from the ones we used for the for establishing the classification criteria, this means that it's workable. It can generalize. العلم كله بيبقى هدفه ان انا بحط قاعده قابله للتعميم فالفاليديشن ان انا باخد البيانات اللي خدتها من الاستادي الاولانيه بحطها على جروب ثانيه من العيانين وبتاكد ان البيانات الاولانيه قابله للتطبيق على المجموعه الثانيه وده اللي بيديها مصداقيه. To validate this classification criteria اللي اتعملت في اوروب for CV, cryoglomerulonephritis vasculitis, with the participation of non-European countries. The countries that shared in this were Egypt and Japan only. The European group was mainly a Mediterranean group from Greece, Italy mainly, France, Spain, and Spain. The classification versus diagnosis. A key question regarding a patient with positive serum cryoglobulin is, when should CV or cryoglobulinemic vasculitis be classified? This is a particular challenge if the clinical history fails to reveal overt features of vasculitis. Question number two is, which is not infrequently asked in clinical practice, is in a patient negative for serum cryoglobulins by initial testing, but with some disease features that support the inclusion of CV in the differential diagnosis, when should CV be suspected? يعني أنا لو ما عنديش cryoglobulins, أنت هقول إن ده وارد. أنا قلنا في الأصل إن ممكن يكون negative cryoglobulins لو التكنيك مش مظبوط, السحب في درجة حرارة منخفضة, السنتريفيوج في درجة حرارة درجة حرارة مش مناسبة 37, ما خدتش كمية دم كفاية, ما استنيتش مدة كافية, إلى آخره إلى آخره. لكن في عيانين ما بقدرش ألاقيها وساعات الليفل بتاعي بيبقى variable. ده السؤال العويص. Serum cryoglobulins may prove negative in their first determination, but a CV may still be strongly suspected, and clinical decisions must be made accordingly. While proper classification has mainly epidemiologic and research purposes and needs a higher specificity, a diagnosis of CV has a key clinical relevance for immediate decision making and can still be formulated in the absence of a positive classification criteria. ده المبدا اللي احنا عايزين نقوله يعني. And the higher sensitivity accompanied by an acceptable specificity is needed. انا هنا مش عايز السبيسيتي العاليه قوي اللي انا عايزها في كلاسيفيكيشن كرايتيريا لان انا مش كومبيرنج جروب انا عايز اخد قرار لعيان فردي. Classification criteria are often used for diagnostic purposes as well, but this is not an appropriate application. مش ده الصح as exemplified by the patient with negative cryoglobulins by initial testing but in whom CV is still strongly suspected. ده اللي انا بقوله ان انا لازم ما اعتمدش عليه. لو انا بعمل دراسه عايز كرايوكريت 1.5 ويقعد 12 اسبوع 1.5% انا اسف. لكن انا لو عندي عيان عايز علاج مش هستنى كل المده دي عشان اعمل الكرايوجلوبولينز وبعدها بعد 12 اسبوع انا لازم اخد ديسيجن سريع. وممكن الليفل بتاعي يبقى اقل من 1.5 فمش هينطبق عليه الكلاسيفيكيشن كرايتيريا بتاعتي لان الساينك 1 بتاعي ان انا الاقي كرايوجلوبولينز 1.5%. ده مثال بضرب بيه عشان ابين الفرق بين الكلاسيفيكيشن كرايتيريا والدياجنوستيك كرايتيريا. The preliminary classification criteria for the cryoglobulinemic syndrome or vasculitis were introduced by DeVita in 2011. We have to satisfy at least two of the three items. The questionnaire, where the clinical laboratory يكونوا positive, or the patient must be positive for serum cryos in at least two determinations at more than 12-week interval. زي ما بنعمل في الانتيفوسفوليبيد سيندروم. والكرايوكريت المطلوب هنا ما يقلش عن 1.5%. لو أكتر يبقى أحسن. Questionnaire اللي حلو يعني انا عايز questionnaire ومعاه clinical او laboratory. Do you remember one or more episodes of small red spots on your skin, particularly involving the lower limbs? طبعا ده history. Have you ever had red spots on your lower extremities which leave a brownish color after their disappearance? Has the doctor ever told you that you have viral hepatitis? دول الأسئلة لو أنا جاوبت على اثنين منهم يبقى أنا الكوستيونير خد النقطة بتاعتي. In clinical, the clinical item, at least three out of the following four should be present or past. They should be present now or were present in the past. Constitutional symptoms, fatigue, low-grade fever. Fever أكثر من 38. Low-grade fever أكثر من 10 أيام طبعاً. Fibromyalgia. Articular involvement, arthralgia or arthritis. Vascular involvement, the Raynaud's or purpura, or necrotizing vasculitis, or skin ulcers, or hyperviscosity syndrome, or neurologic involvement, أهمه, peripheral neuropathy, or cranial nerve, or vasculitic CNS involvement, زي اللي شفناها في الأشعة. A laboratory item, at least two out of the following three, should be present, reduced serum C4, وده احنا هنلاقي ان الاسوشيشن بتاعه أعلى واحد, a positive serum rheumatoid factor, or positive serum M component, serum protein electrophoresis followed by immunofixation. The results of the classification criteria for cryoglobulinemic vasculitis validation studies were published, were presented at two international conferences and then were published in the Journal of Rheumatology by Oxford. The results for cryoglobulinemic vasculitis validation study where we studied 643 patients were enrolled, 268 patients in group A, 182 controls in group B, and 193 controls in group C. Overall, missing data were less than 10%. Composition of group A and B are explained below. 20 patients showed type 1 cryoglobulinemia. طبعا دول أقل عدد, 13 group A and 7 in group B. دول اللي هم monoclonal gamma. Group C was characterized by 108 from the patients, 55.9 systemic vasculitis, and were small vessel vasculitis, 92% of whom were small vessel disease. These are the characteristics of the group A and group B. The classification criteria A versus B, a comparison between مجموعة A and مجموعة B. أنا لما باجي أشوف بقارن مجموعتين بحب أشوف الكومباريتورز اللي أنا استعملتهم. فالمجموعة A كانت عندها كرايوجلوبولينز من التايب بتاعي هيباتيتس سي اللي هو متفقين عليه, بشوف بينطبق عليها الكريتيريا اللي حطها دي فيتا 2011 ولا المجموعه بي عندها كرايوجلوبولينز بس لاسباب اخرى غير هيباتيتس سي فايروس. الكويستشنير اتليست احنا قلنا 2 to 3 بوزيتيف انسر شود 89% بانتر كونفيدنس انترفال من 95% اتك 95% كونفيدنس انترفال ما بين 85.1 with 92.9 of sensitivity, 93.4 sensitivity specificity. The clinical item, احنا قلنا questionnaire, clinical item showed 75% تقريبا lower sensitivity, 89% specificity. Laboratory item showed positivity showed 80% sensitivity, تقريباً, with 62% specificity. The final classification criteria, لما بجمعهم مع بعض questionnaire وclinical واللاب, كانت بتدينا 89.9% of sensitivity, 93.5% of specificity. A sensitivity of 91.7% specificity of 100% were also observed when considering only type 1 cryoglobulins اللي قلنا ان ده كان الماينورتي اوف كيسز. Classification criteria A versus C, لما قارنت A versus C كان مطلوب ان انا اختار في المجموعة C حالات vasculitis mainly بنفضل small vessel disease عشان ده الاقرب ككومباريتور بالنسبة للكلاسيفيكيشن بالنسبة لل HCV cryoglobulinemic vasculitis او collagen disease including Sjögren أو lupus لكن ما معهمش cryoglobulins. المجموعة C ما فيهاش cryoglobulins اللي اخترناها by selection أو inclusion. لكن يكون collagen disease mainly lupus أو Sjögren syndrome كانوا مطلوبين بصفة خاصة أو vasculitic syndromes. Questionnaire ده هنا بنقارن A مع C. Questionnaire كان sensitivity 89.6 و specificity 56.5. A clinical item can 75 sensitivity, 42 specificity. Laboratory can 80% sensitivity, 92 specificity تقريبا. Positivity of 2 to 3, out of 3 positive items showed 89.9 of sensitivity, but a lower specificity, low 66.1. However, if positive laboratory item as mandatory item to suspect cryoglobulinemic vasculitis, the comparison between group A versus group C showed sensitivity of 77% and a specificity of 92.6%. لو أنا حطيت الشرط الضروري اللي هو الكرايوغلوبلز لأن المجموعة C وهي بتتفحص ما كان مطلوب إن ما يكونش عندهم الكرايوغلوبلز. Cryoglobulinemic vasculitis validation study methods can 20 centers from Europe, Egypt, or Japan. New consecutive unselected patients CV or cryoglobulinemic vasculitis and control subjects with cryoglobulinemia without cryoglobulinemic vasculitis based on the golden standard clinical judgment بتاع الجروب. Group B were studied. A sample size of 140 patients for each group was estimated to obtain a sensitivity and a specificity of at least 90 plus minus 5%. ده اللي احنا طلبناه في الاول وده اللي اتحقق في النتائج النهائية according to the previous results. اللي هي 12/2011 a dedicated chart was distributed to the centers. هعدي على الشرط بسرعة لأن كان فيها داتا كتيرة. Sensitivity and specificity of 2011 classification criteria were calculated in the present validation series by comparing group A versus group B. احنا عدينا على الريزلتس مش عايز ارجع لها تاني. ده الشارت اللي هو كان ذا اكسل شيت بيتملي بالبيانات تخص الانتيتيز اللي هي البيرسونال داتا الكويستشنير الكلينيكال فايندينج اللابوراتوري فايندينج والحاجات الخاصه بالليمفو بروليفريشن. ده الكلاسيفيكيشن كرايتيريا اوف cryoglobulinemic vasculitis ودلوقتي بقت فاليديتد واستابليشد ككرايتيريا. اند هاو اباوت مانجمنت اوف cryoglobulinemic vasculitis؟ الحقيقة أن في تطورات جديدة طبعاً إحنا عارفين novel agents للtreatment of mixed cryoglobulinemia TNF inhibitors were not successful ولا الإيماتينيب novel agents for the treatment of type 1 cryoglobulinemia أعتقد أنتم ممكن تكلمونا عنه أكتر ما أنا أقدر أتكلم لأن دي بتوجه في هذا الاتجاه بورتيزوميب في أبحاث منشورة عنه rituximab for the treatment of severe cryoglobulinemic vasculitis ده 12 paper في برمنغهام vasculitis activity score decreased only after treatment with rituximab the severe cryoglobulinemic vasculitis اللي هي ما تقدرش تستعمل anti HCV therapy وده 12/2012 قبل الفترة اللي احنا عايشينها دلوقتي اللي هي direct acting antiviral drugs أو anti HCV drugs at baseline to 7.1 plus or minus 5.7 rituximab appeared to be superior therapy for all three target organ manifestations اللي هي الكيدني والCNS mainly والأسف والنيرفوس سيستم والبلد and it was as effective as conventional therapy the median duration of response to rituximab was 18 months rituximab monotherapy حتى in the absence of antiviral therapy represented a very good option for severe cryoglobulinemic vasculitis and can be maintained over the long term of in most patients. انا عايز اقول ان الدراسه دي اتنشرت وكان معاها دراسه ثانيه امريكان دي ايطاليان ستادي في جامعه اودين, والستادي دي اتوقفت بعد فتره فور اثيكال ريزنز, اتوقفت لان الارمز الثانيه بتاعت الستادي اللي كان فيها سيكلوفوسفامايد كانت باي فار انفيرير للارم بتاع ريتوكسيناب, فما كانش اخلاقيا مسموح ان احنا نكمل في علاج احنا للمقارنه الكامله مع عقار واضح انه مش جايب نتيجه كويسه, والعيانين كان لازم ياخدوا البنفيت بتاع الدواء اللي كان من البدايه مدي نتائج احسن كتير. فريتوكسيناب كان استابليشت هنا سنه 2012 وفي نفس العدد ده من مجله 12 دراسه امريكيه بعدد اقل, وكانت بتؤدي الى نفس النتائج. انا عايز اعدي على السلايد ده بسرعه. لو انا حطيت بلان للثيرابي ونقف لغايه سنه 2013 و14 عشان نتكلم على مانجمنت اوف كرايبلوميت سيندروم, لان احنا عندنا كلام جديد بنحب نقول اتش سي في زائد اسيمتوماتيك بيشنت وذ ميكس كرايبلوبين, يا اما اتش سي في اسوشيت ام سي لو ميكس كرايبلوبينيميا, اذا كانت اسيمتوماتيك اذا ما كانش في انديكيشن انتي فايرال ثيرابي بيزد اون هيباتيك ديزيز هنحط العين فولو اب, لكن اذا كان في دليل او داعي هيباتيك هنستعمل انترفيرون بلس ريفافايرين. احنا بنتكلم هنا على سنه 2012, طبعا الكلام الجديد مختلف خالص يعني دخلت ادويه جديده, وانا I will go through a hint on novel therapies. يا اما اذا كان سيمتوماتيك, اذا كان مايل تو مودريت هنستعمل انتي فايرال ثيرابي, اذا كان سيفير ديزيز هنستعمل ريتوكسيناب, اذا كان لايف ثريتنينج سيمتومز بلازما اكسشينج كان 6 to 9 sessions over 2 weeks 2 to 3 weeks, وبعد كده بندخل ستيرويدز وامينوسبريسنت او بلس اور ماينس ريتوكسيناب. والحقيقه هنا باي لايف ثريتنينج نقصد سيفير رينال او سيفير نيورولوجيكال مانيفيستيشن, الجلد ما بيدخلش هنا, كوتينيوس مانيفيستيشن ما بيدخلش في اللايف ثريتنينج, ممكن تدخل في سيفير ديزيز مع التو سيستمز الثانيين. الحقيقه الريسك مع كارديوميك فاسكولايتس وبرايمات جوجرن سيندروم ده الاريا اوف اوفرلاب بتاعه الليمف بروليفريشن اوتو اميونيتي, والاثنين بيتميزوا بصفات جزء منها اوتو اميون وجزء منها بيبروسيد الى ليمفوما او نون هوجكن ليمفوما ان بارتيكولر. الحقيقه البيبر دي اتنشرت في اليولار اللي هو المؤتمر الاوروبي سنه 2015 في روما, وبعد كده اتنشرت في الانز والريزوماتيك ديزيز ان احنا برايمري جوجرين وكرايبلومينيك فاسكولايتس ار اندبندنت ريسك فاكتورز فور ليمفوما ان ا لارج وورلد وايد بوبيليشن اوف بيشنتس وذ بوزيتيف سيرم كرايبلوبين. الاثنين اندبندنت ريسك فاكتورز, مش ما كانتش اوفرلاب ما بين الاثنين. النقطه اللي ناقصه ان انا اقولها الحقيقه ان احنا الكلام بتاعنا كله وقف عند 2012 ريبافيرين مع البيجيليتد انترفير. دخول الانتي دايركت انتي اتش سي في دراجز انا ام لافت وذ فيو ووردز بس غير المفهوم وابتدينا نحاول نعمل دراسه. هشوف انا لو دخلت بالانتي فايرال ثيرابي كتريجر للاوتو اميونيتي في الحاله دي, لو انا خلصت من التريجر هل الوضع هيبقى احسن في الديزيز؟ الحقيقه احنا مسجلين بيبر مع وزاره مع معهد الكبد واخده دعم من الاس تي دي اف عشان نشوف تاثير السوفوسبيوفر في الدول وتريبل ثيرابي او النوبل دراجز على مجموعه كبيره من التراجلوميك سيندروم بيشنتس. النتائج الاوليه لسه ما اتنشرتش لكن بروميسنج. الحقيقه سبقنا في القصه دي مجموعه بتاعت باريس بتاعت جامعه باريس بروفيسور باتريس كاكوب والمجموعه بتاعته, نشروا في نوفمبر اللي فات في المؤتمر في سان فرانسيسكو نتائج استخدام اول علاج للاتش سي في من غير الانترفيرون فري, وكانت النتائج فيري بروميسنج في السيطره على الديزيز على السكين لوجيكال وعلى الكواليتي اوف لايف للعيانين اللي عندهم كرايبلوميك فاسكولايتس. في النهايه بكرر الشكر على صبركم في نهايه يوم شاق ومؤتمر شاق, وشكرا جزيلا للبانل.
Thank you very much, Professor Ghaffar Raghab, for your very, very illustrative and practical issue about cryoglobulinemia or cryoglobulinic vasculitis. Is there any questions?